We're live on Periscope, Facebook, and YouTube.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Alrighty then. We are live on Periscope, Facebook, and YouTube. Three different sites, so we just pray that the right people tune in and come on, that they need something and they get what the Lord needs to give them. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. This morning, I talked about trusting the Lord and just resting in Him and letting Him be faithful in your life as you're faithful in Him, and not to get too, you know, don't worry about what the future holds, how the Lord will bless you. We read out of Psalms 37, actually. We read the whole chapter, Psalms 37, and we read where God talks about not fretting because it only causes harm in our lives, and not giving over into worry and what God was going to do to the wicked. You know what I mean? And it's pretty wild because I don't want to be on the other side. I want to be on God's side. Amen. Amen. And you know how He was going to be faithful to His people. Then it said in there in Psalms 37, it says that the enemy tries to come after the righteous. He tries to come after the people of God. But God sits in the heavens and He laughs, it says, at His attempt to do that, because He knows that He cannot touch God's anointed, which is us. Amen. And so, you know, we're learning how to rest in the Lord. Number one, I believe that, I pray that we are growing as the body of Christ on realizing really who our God is, how powerful He is, how mighty He is, and how much He loves us, and how much He wants to take care of us, because He loves us. If He didn't love us, He wouldn't have sent His Son. Right? So that's out of the question. We know that He loves us. We know He wants to take care of us. But it's our job to a certain point to allow Him to do that in our lives. And one way to allowing God to show His love on you, to walk in His love and understand His love, is just by being honest with yourself about your life. That's a big thing. I noticed that my life didn't change, and I stayed the same person and dealt with the same habits, same thing, because I didn't make a decision to be honest with myself and cut those things off and go another direction. A lot of the things that hinders most Christians in their lives are the people they associate with. That's a big thing. It really is. I know some people frown upon that. Well, we need to be saviors to this world and we need to minister Jesus. You're absolutely correct, 150% on that. We need to do that. But there's some times where you are not going to be that disciple in that person's life. I remember Brother Al Bahusky, he was here one day ministering, and he used me as an example. He had me stand up on this chair right here, as he stood right here, and he said, now you might pull me up on that chair with you. It was impossible. I couldn't do it. He said, now watch this. He jerked on me and pulled me right off the chair. And he says, that's what happens when we hang out with people that aren't going the direction that we want to go. It's way easier for people to influence you out of it than you pulling them in. Now, I know that sounds, you might think to myself, well, I'll never get influenced. Don't say that. No. I've heard a lot of preachers over the years say that. They had big churches and good ministries going, all this kind of stuff. I'll never get into that. And then the next thing you know, they're out having an affair on their wife. Come on. No, we all can be influenced by the devil if we allow it. But you know what really will keep us from getting influenced to the point to where we make a huge mistake or something like that? Is having a prayer life. Yeah. Spending time with the Lord. That'll keep us. That'll keep the devil flushed out. When the devil attacks your mind, you'll know that you don't need to go over into that, because His love, your love for the Father, and all that on will be on you so strong that you will not want to go that direction. Look, I know better than to leave this place. If I know that I walk into the store across the street with a handgun and point it at the person and say, give me your money, I'm going to jail. That's common sense, right? So we know we shouldn't do that. But there's other things that the enemy, I know I won't go do that, but there's other things the enemy, there's plans that the enemy has for you, just like plans God has for you. And it's his job as the enemy to try to entice you into something that he knows can get you into problems. Not only on this, see, look, the devil wants to humiliate you while you're on earth. He knows he doesn't have your soul because you're born again. So he just wants to make you as miserable and humiliate you the best he can while you're here on earth. He sets trap after trap after trap. Now, understand, I'm not praising our enemy. I'm just saying that's how he works. But it is. It's his MO. But when we stay hooked in with our Creator, with our Maker, with our Master, with Father God, hallelujah, when we stay hooked into him and we're close to him and we talk to him and we love on him and we worship him, those traps will be exposed by the enemy. Amen. They will. Listen, have you ever noticed that, let's say you're up for 24 hours straight. Maybe some of you just worked a 12-hour shift overnight or something. And you get home, you just got off work, and you're pretty tired. Your mind's tired. Physically, your mind is tired. It's hard to even make decisions sometimes, or when you're driving, you find yourself kind of, you know, fall asleep and drifting, and you have to, you know, your mind gets tired. But what happens when you get home, you get into bed, you get that good 8 hours of sleep, and you wake up in the morning, you're nice and fresh, what happens? Your mind's clear. Your mind's clear. You're able to make decisions. You're able to be on top of things. You're not tired. Why? Because you rested. It's the same thing with following the Lord. When we learn to live in His rest, not only is our mind clear to make decisions, rational decisions, but our spirit man is strong. And we can hear in the spirit. Listen, I put this to the test, and I know some of you have, but I wanted to hear more from God. And the way that I know that I can hear more from God and have Him speak to me more is drawing closer to Him. Making myself available more to Him so I can hear Him more.
Amen.
Amen. And I know that's pretty well done, Pastor Mike, you know, but it's the truth. If we want to hear somebody more, we'll get closer to Him. Come on. And God is awesome because He says, just ask, and I'll talk to you. Just ask, and I'll show you things that come. Just ask, and I'll give to you. You know, this morning, I'm sitting in my easy boy chair, getting ready for church, just meditating before everybody got up, spending time with the Lord. And I said, Father, if there's something you want to speak to me today about the service this morning, if there's a word you want to give me or something, there's somebody there, or something needs something, Lord, if you want to share with me, share with me. Within 5 minutes, I heard Him give me that word of knowledge, bone disease, osteoporosis. I heard it just like that in my spirit. And there was two people that came up for that today. As a matter of fact, Brother Mike, the big guy Mike, he told me after service, he came back up and he said, you know, that my hip isn't feeling as stiff as it was when I came up here. And he said, I'm actually straight now. He said, I feel straight.
Thank you.
I don't feel bent over. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Sounds like the Lord's doing a work in His hip.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Praise
God. So see, we just got to ask the Lord. Just ask. He wants to meet your need. He wants to talk to you. He wants to use you like we read about this morning. He wants to use you to increase His kingdom. He'll give you words. He'll give you things to say to people. He'll have you pray certain things. He'll have you say certain things to people. He'll have you give them certain things. Praise God, because He wants to increase His kingdom.
Yeah.
He delights in that. He delights in us that we want to be used by Him to increase His kingdom. Praise the Lord. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. So we're at work. God's at hand. God's doing good things. He's blessing us. He's taking care of us. He's bringing us in to a new level of Him. He's loving on us. His wisdom and knowledge and revelation is so wonderful, so powerful. We can receive it if we'll just ask Him. Praise God. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Now, many of us know that there's an election coming up. And I had this paper sent to me. Mom sent this to me here last week. It's from a lady by the name of Penny Jackson is her name. And she She is from Houston, Texas, and she's a prayer warrior, a lady along those lines. And she sent this to an apostle by the name of Chuck Pierce. Some of you have heard of Chuck Pierce. She sent it to Chuck Pierce, and he kind of put it out. And Mom sent this to me, and it's 10 points of prayer to pray before this election comes. And I want to share these, and maybe some of you might want to write some things down or not or whatever, but I just want to share this with you.
And that's this one.
Oh, yeah, you still have some, don't you? Yeah, if you want one, go ahead and stick your hand up in the air. Brother Jim will give you. I made some copies of that here last week. And if you want one of those, if you didn't get one, you're welcome to take one. And we'll look at this here. And I want to share these prayer points tonight, and I want to, then I'm going to read some scriptures here on some things here. And so tonight's just kind of one of those deals where the Lord's just talking to us, and He wants us to be battle ready. He wants us to be battle ready, hallelujah. Put on the armor of God, amen? So we can pray, so we can intercede, so we can spend time in His presence, so we can go forth in the land. So it says here, it says, Dear friends, last year in October, we were in Ohio. I saw angels of chaos and confusion being sent to America to awaken us out of slumber we are in. At a Passover, I prophesied that this September and October, talking about this September, the month of October we're in right now, would be two of the nastiest we have known. Now, this was last year that this prophetic word came to her about this time. It says, that's in September, Penny Jackson from Houston sent me this. This is Chuck Pierce talking, obviously. The Lord spoke to her and gave her a strategy for prayer. The prayer points are very helpful to remind you of who you are in Christ this season. The Lord says things will get more heated now as the election approaches. When September begins, something will shift, and not in a good way. Lies will be spoken, and truth will be twisted. Media will join the fray to an even greater extent. It is a time to keep counsel with me. Nothing you hear can be trusted unless I reveal it to you. Turn to me for truth and ignore the facts that the world will tell you. Number one, pray for evil. Now wait, hold on a second. Let me read that part again there we just read. It is a time to keep counsel with who? God.
Amen. Yep.
Nothing you hear can be trusted unless I reveal it to you. Turn to me for truth and ignore the facts that the world will tell you. Now what God's saying there is, look, He's going to tell us things about the days ahead. There's going to be certain things we're going to hear from Him, but most of the stuff that we need to know about the days ahead are right here in the Word of God.
Yeah.
You know, we should know, here's an example, we should know not to agree with abortion.
Amen.
We should know that.
Right.
That's
Amen.
Common sense
Amen.
In God's Word.
Yeah,
the shedding of innocent blood
Amen.
Brings a curse on the land, the Bible says.
Right.
That's what it says.
Yeah. That's it.
So that's pretty plain, okay? So that's one example. We know, there's certain facts that we know spiritually, what God has said, that He likes or doesn't like. Okay, so that just makes sense. Okay? Number one, pray for evil in government and in the world to reveal itself to the point that it cannot be masked any longer. Number two, pray that the body will rise above its place of fear and hiding and will step into its place of increased intercession.
Yes.
Number three, pray that my children will remember who they are and will take authority in the realm around them. See, guys, God has given us territory. And wherever He's placed you and put you, praise God, you have authority in that realm, in that region. You have the authority there. You have authority in your family. You have authority over your children, your grandchildren. You have authority in your neighborhood. You have the authority to speak and use your mouth by the word of the Lord and proclaim that God will do what He needs to do in that realm, in that territory. Praise the Lord. You have authority over the government in this city.
Amen. Yeah.
In the heavens, you have authority to pray over it. Amen. And to bless it. Isn't that awesome what they did in city council? They put on the wall, "In God we trust."
Hallelujah.
Right above the, right next to the heart of Madera there.
Awesome. Yeah.
In God we trust.
Amen.
Come on, that right there is something to grab onto.
Amen.
And work with.
Amen.
Lord, they proclaim, "In God we trust" over our city.
Amen.
That's huge. We've taken ground right there.
There you go.
The devil hates it, but too bad. We've taken ground, praise the Lord. Putting God first. Amen. That's a big step, guys. It's a good thing. Number four. Pray that what I have worked in them will cause them to rise up in the fullness of who they are and who I have made them to be.
Amen.
Number five. I have done much in my body in the past season. Pray that not one bit of that will fall to the ground as things begin to shake more violently. Number six. Pray that they will keep their focus on me and not on the world around them. That's big right there. We got to pray that not only maybe for ourselves for that, but for our brothers and sisters, that they won't keep their eyes on what's going on around them, but they'll keep their eyes in the Spirit and what God is saying about that. Amen?
Yep.
Number seven, pray that they will seek me and not the media.
Yep.
Number eight, pray that they will see through the lies around them and will not fall prey to the works of the enemy.
Yep.
Number nine, the times are so strategic and my people must step into place. There is not time for hesitation. But it is a time to stop and listen for my voice. It is a time to seek wisdom. Now listen, it is a time to seek wisdom in everything.
Amen.
Pray for wisdom for my people.
Amen.
You know, I was telling the prayer group Tuesday morning here and then this last Wednesday, people that were here, that last week on Monday, the Lord just all day was like, it was on me all day just to speak. That the people in this congregation, the people that come to this church, that they would just flow in the wisdom and the revelation of God. That they would have wisdom to do what God has called them to do. That they would fulfill their plan and their purpose. It was like all day, that just kept impressing on me Monday. And I just kept speaking it and praying over the congregation in this church. Praise God. But praying for wisdom. That we have wisdom from the Father God. To do what He's called us to do. Listen, God is a very strategic God. He wants to give you strategy. He wants to give you pieces to the puzzle for the future. He wants to show you things. Just an example in my life. Two summers ago, I remember we were having praise and worship here. And two summers ago, in my spirit, I saw a map of the United States of America. And it was like it was on the ground in front of me. And I was looking at it, at this map on the ground there. And I saw, all of a sudden, I saw these whirlwinds start to form over every single state in our country, in our nation. And these whirlwinds would form over these states. And they would be right over the center of each state. And they weren't touching the ground yet. They were still hovering over, and they were swirl and swirl and swirl. And I thought, man, Lord, what is that? You know? And He didn't respond to me and show me what that was for several months down the road. I didn't have a witness on that. And all of a sudden, I start hearing these prophetic words come out last year about the wind of the Lord, the winds of God, the tornadoes of God, the wind of the Spirit of God, all these different all these different prophecies about the wind and the wind and the wind. And I had that little experience in the back alley back here that day with a little wind devil. They call those things wind devils, but I call them wind angels now.
Amen.
It's a little wind storm blow down through this alley and go right past me out through the alley, and there was no wind even blowing. The flag across the street was as limp as can be. And it was like, God, what is that? And it was like, I'm showing you that my wind's blowing. It's coming. It was a sign to me. God tells us not to seek signs, but He'll show us things. He'll show us things sometimes. I remember back in the mid-2000s, before I even had that, this came back to me this morning during church. God reminded me of this in my spirit. But before I saw those whirlwinds over the nation, that was two summers ago. This is back in the mid-2000s. I was here one night, and I was in the building by myself, and I was just came down here to spend some time with the Lord by myself. And I was sitting in the office in the chair just worshiping the Lord. And all of a sudden, the Lord just impressed on me. He told me, get up and go out and start to blow. Start to blow. I said, well, where? He said, just step out and do it. I stepped down the hallway, and I blew down the hallway. He had me coming down to the sanctuary and just blow over each section. Prophetically blow the wind of the Lord. And some of you might be, well, I don't know about that. Well, God will have us perform prophetic acts in the Spirit for certain things. I've seen Him do it for years with people. And this is back in the mid-2000s. All of a sudden, we get up to around 2013, 2014, and we start hearing these prophetic words about the wind of God coming to America. And He starts showing me all these things. See, God will show us things way before He wants to start causing it to happen in a certain place. Why does He do that? Because He wants us to get a hold of that and start praying for it. Amen. He wants us to get a hold of that and start seeking Him concerning that. That's like this morning. You know, the word of the Lord came to us and said that He's given a promotion in our right hand.
Amen.
I told that to Dad this afternoon. He's like, man, I want to dig into that a little bit. And I said, yeah, me too. I want to dig into that a little bit too. Because I don't fully understand that. There are certain things, you know, the right hand represents authority and things like that, but I think there's more to it than just that. Yep. But He's given us authority on this earth. A lot of people mock, you know, Christians, oh, well, you know, so if I just speak to this, it'll change. In faith, it will. When you speak to it in faith. We speak to it in faith. Mark 11, 23, 24 says, say that mountain be removed and cast into the sea. And whatever you ask in His name, and you don't doubt in your heart, He'll give it to you. I know that a lot of people would use those scriptures and, you know, God, give me a Mercedes, you know, and just, you know, all this kind of stuff. There's nothing wrong with wanting a certain car, nothing wrong with wanting that kind of stuff. But we should want to seek God to do our ministry. And then He'll bless us as we do our ministries on this earth. As we're faithful to Him, He'll see to it that He blesses us with things that we enjoy. There's nothing wrong with that. Amen? Amen. That's a whole, I don't want to get off that whole lot. So it says, pray for wisdom for my people. Number 10. Pray that the path each is to take will become clearer and clearer with each passing day. And then at the bottom it says, let the battle begin. We don't fight against flesh and blood. We talked about that this morning a little bit. We don't fight against flesh and blood. We fight the Spirit. And you know what? God says, look, I've already won the battle for you. I sent my Son. He took care of the enemy. It's over with. But you still, on this earth, as a believer, as a child of God, have got to take a stand. You've got to take a stand. You've got to stick your feet in the ground. And you've got to say, I am not wavering from the word of the Lord. I'm not wavering from what God has told me. I'm not wavering from what Jesus Christ has done for me and my family. And we are standing and we will proclaim the name of Jesus. We will proclaim that God's hand is in our nation. We will proclaim that God puts the right people where they need to be. Praise God. Yeah. We will proclaim that evil is exposed, that darkness is exposed, and the glory of the Lord and common sense will come back to this nation.
Amen. Yes. Yeah.
There's an old country song, the lyrics used to say, you got to stand for something or you'll fall for anything.
Yeah, that's right.
You got to stand for something. And I know by looking at everybody in here, whether I know you real, real well or whether I hardly know you at all, you're standing for Jesus Christ or you wouldn't even be in this building tonight.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. So these are just some prayer here. You can keep before you and just ask the Lord to use you with that. If there's something He wants you to pray specifically out of this or something grabs you there, just flow with the Spirit of God in that. Amen. Turn over to Psalms 91. Psalms 91. Praise God. The devil's a liar. Amen. We are victorious. Hallelujah. Amen. Psalms 91, look here, verse 1. It says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." Praise God. Now, that word dwells there means lives. Say it that way. He who lives in the secret place. What's the secret place? The presence of the Lord. He who lives in the presence of the Lord shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You know what can be another refuge for you? Not just God, but you know what else can be another refuge for you? Is the local church God has put you in.
Yes, amen. That's right.
Well, how is that? Well, because God will put you with people there that will pray for you, that will encourage you, that will love on you and your families, that will bless you, that will help you. That's another portion of life that there's refuge. Amen. I thank God for my church family.
Yeah, me too.
And I don't say that just because I'm a pastor and that's what I do, but I do thank God for my church family. You know, if God, when God called mom and dad up here in 1983 to start a church, they've been doing this here since 1983. Most pastors don't make it that long. When God tells them to go somewhere, they pack up and leave within 5 years. Average. You know what? Mom and dad knew they were called up here and they didn't leave for nothing.
Amen.
They've had windows broke out, tires slashed, death threats. Dad has supposedly slept with almost all the women in Madera. Let's see, what else? We worship snakes here. What else? Oh, we have a crystal ball that hangs from our sanctuary over on G Street when we were over there. All kinds of stuff. I mean, I should write a book about the comedies that have been said, you know? Things that have been said. But they called them here, and they knew they were called, and they weren't going to leave unless God told them to leave. That's how I was raised. If God tells you to do something, you do it. You do it the rest of your life, or unless he tells you to do something else or tells you to move or whatever. Amen. That's just how I was raised. And I know that God called him here. And if he called him here just for 10 people for 50 years,
I'm all right.
They would do it.
Yeah, that's right.
You look at your life. What has God called you to do? And if you're doing it right now, it doesn't matter what it looks like on the outside. You just keep obeying God and just listening to his voice and doing what he's called you to do, because he's going to bless you and keep you and help you and protect you. Praise God. Amen. I know not everybody in here will stand up before, you know, like you guys stand at the pulpit and preach the word of the Lord. I know that not everybody's called to do that. And folks, I want to tell you right now, I tried to run from that. I didn't want to do that. Just being honest. But when the Lord talks to you and says, "You do what I tell you, you're going to be in big problems and it ain't going to be my fault," you know, you kind of wake up. You know what I'm saying? And so, we all are ministers unto the Lord. All of us. See, I prefer that here in this local church, that me and dad and mom aren't the only ones that does everything here. We prefer that people that come here and have submitted themselves here, and this is their local church, and they're growing here, and they're feeding here, and they're growing, their families are coming in, and things are happening. We prefer that you guys bless others and pray for others and help others.
Amen.
That's what we want to see. And you know what's awesome is we see that here in this local body. We see the Lord using people that go here, man, mightily. And their gifts. And it's awesome, man. It's awesome. I don't know why I got off on all that, but a good local church is a good place to be.
Amen.
It's a good thing. Amen?
Amen. Yes, it is.
Verse 2. "I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him I will trust.
Yes.
Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler." What's the fowler? Anybody know what the fowler is?
Yeah.
It's the enemy. The fowler was like a bird trap or a snare. He'll deliver us from that. The traps of the enemy. We were talking about that earlier. And from the perilous pestilence. There you go. Everyone's trying to freak you out about, what is it, the Zika virus or something? No pestilence will come nigh my dwelling. It will not.
Well, you're pretty arrogant, aren't you?
No, I just believe the word of the Lord.
Amen.
I've had people say it to me, well, yeah, well, you think, you know, you're never going to get the flu. No, I resist the flu. I will not have the flu in my body or my family. It's flu season. Run for your lives. No, thanks. I'll just stay home and resist in Jesus' name.
Right by me.
That's it. There you go. Flew right by me. Amen. Yeah. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. If you get the flu shot, that's fine. Whatever. You do what you feel like you need to do. If I don't feel good, I go to the doctor sometimes.
Yep.
Okay, nothing wrong with that. But it's not going to change how I feel and what the Word of God says about my life. And what He says about healing, what He says about it. There's a foundation. The rock. Amen.
Yeah.
So forget pestilence, praise God. Verse 4, He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. Isn't that, that sounds like a good spot for you to rest in the Lord, right under His wings and His refuge. Take shelter in His refuge. Take shelter in His wings. Just lay there, let rest in His presence. Daily, take time to do that. It says, His truth shall be your shield and your buckler. His truth. I've noticed that when I spend time in the presence of the Lord and I rest in Him, I know His truth. Truth starts to develop in my life. Maybe there's things about my life that I was living deceived in and I didn't understand or I didn't know, and the devil was deceiving me. When I spend time in His rest and under His in His presence and under His refuge, there's times where God will reveal truth to us. Not only about Him, but about us. Where we see certain things in our life. Oh, that's where the enemy was tricking me, and I didn't understand that. I was blinded when it came to that. But now I see the snare of the enemy, the trap of the enemy. God just revealed His truth to you. God just revealed His truth to me to get me out of that. That's what He'll do. Sometimes He'll send people in our past to reveal truth to us. That's happened to me several times where Dad, a lot of times, would come and God would use Him to reveal truth in my life, and there was times where I would reject that truth. Because I was blinded maybe in a certain area that I thought I had it together and I wasn't living that way, but I really was. Until finally you come to a point where you realize, wait a minute here. The devil had me trapped in that area and I didn't even know it. But God, that's how awesome He is. He reveals that to us. Now don't, you know, hold yourself in some kind of condemnation. Oh, you know, there's all kinds of things in me. No. Follow the Lord. Seek Him. Rest in Him. Let Him be your refuge. Get underneath those wings, and He'll reveal truth to you about your life. When you're honest with Him. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Verse 5. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lies waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because, verse 9, because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place.
Yeah.
Verse 10, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling.
Amen.
There's your scripture right there. You fight with that. You feel sickness or some kind of deal start to come on you, you stand and say, you will not come nigh my dwelling.
Amen.
And there's times where God will even have you take steps naturally to take care of yourself.
Yeah.
It'll speed the process up.
Amen.
There's one thing I found out in my life using this naturally. When I start to feel like that scratch in your throat, like there's an allergy or some kind of drainage or something like that, God has showed me. God has showed me to irrigate my sinuses. Right when I start to feel that.
Amen.
To naturally irrigate my sinuses with sea salt, warm water, or water, and baking soda. Now that's a remedy. It's out there. It's been known. It's been around for a long time. But I started getting those things the past few years. All of a sudden, it was like I'm getting like sinus deals, and I never had problems with that kind of stuff. And all of a sudden, it started happening in my life. It seemed like 3 or 4 times a year, man, I'd have a sore throat, sinus headache, and all this junk. I'm like, Lord, what's going on? And He showed me that. And He told me, as soon as you feel that, not only stand on my word, but do this naturally. And I started to do that, and it works every time.
Amen.
That stuff doesn't stay. It goes. It flushes away eventually. Within a day or two.
Amen.
Now, you might say, well, you know what? God will show us things, Amen. Man. He'll help us. The Word of God is true, and it's final, and it's established, and it's never dying, and it lives forever, it says.
Yeah.
But He's also given us brains here on earth, too.
Yeah.
For certain things. Amen? But there's your scripture. No plague shall come nigh my family in the name of Jesus. You hear that, devil? You have been destroyed. You have been defeated. You will not harm my family in Jesus' name. And you stand on that word and you believe it. For He, verse 11, for He shall give His angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. There you go. There's a good one for your children, your grandchildren. Father, I thank You that You've given them angels charge over my kids, charge over my grandkids, Father, charge over my marriage. I thank You that You've given angels there to stand by them, to protect them and keep them in Jesus' name. Speak the word. Hallelujah. Glad you're excited tonight about that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You're in deep thought, thinking of the angels going out and kicking some booty for you. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah.
Verse 12. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent. You shall trample underfoot because, now listen to this, I love 14, 15, and 16. Because He has set His love upon me. Therefore, I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. Listen to that. God, because He set His love upon, because we've set our love upon God, He'll deliver us, and He will set us on high because He knows my name, because we know the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Love is a powerful thing, folks. The love of God defeats every single attack, defeats every single enemy, defeats every single sin. The Bible says that love will cast out fear. The Bible says that love covers a multitude of sin. His love will do it for us. Let Him love you. Love Him back. Verse 15. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. God says, I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him with long life.
Amen.
I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Amen.
Those are God's promises to you. This whole Psalm 91 is good, but that verse 14, 15, and 16, you can stand on those words for days and just speak them. God loves us so much. Man, it's you can meditate on those 3 verses. Just, I mean, His love is upon us. He'll deliver us because He loves us. The Bible even says that He's known us since we were born. And He'll carry us since we were born. He'll carry us into our middle age. And He'll carry us into our gray hair age, it says.
Amen.
He's with us. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Glory.
God will give us and satisfy us with long life on this earth. If you want it. I'm telling you, we decide. We decide how we want to live on this earth. We decide. And the only way that I know how to make the right decisions while we're here is by knowing the word of the Lord. That's the only way I know how to make the right decisions. God has already established his word. And when we live in his word, he will cause us, reveal to us, and show us what decisions to make, when to make them, and how to make them. He will. And I'm talking about your life, your ministry, even relationships, even who to marry, who not to marry. I mean, you know what I mean? Just things along the lines as you grow and as you go down this life's pathway. I know there's obviously decisions that we make that we need to make every day. You know, brush your teeth, comb your hair. You know, things like that. We don't have to wait on God to show us those kind of things. But about our life in general, who are we in Christ? What has Jesus done for us? What don't I have to put up with from the devil?
Amen.
How do I take care of that? How do I rebuke him? How do I come against him? How do I use my mouth? Every answer to those questions are in the Word. He'll teach you how to use your mouth. But the main way you can use your mouth, the way there's power, is speaking what he says to you. Once you get a revelation that divine healing is for today, and it didn't pass away with the apostles like some denominations say, then I know that healing's for today. Then I know that if I pray for somebody, they can be healed. Now, it's not my responsibility to heal them.
Amen.
I don't have the power.
Amen.
But Jesus in me does. And by me standing in faith and praying for them, they can receive healing. But ultimately, it's up to the person receiving prayer how they want to receive that, how they want to have that.
Yeah.
See, because listen, I'm going to tell you. When I was going through leukemia in 2008, I had hands laid on me. I had people pray for me. Powerful people would lay their hands on me. Powerful people in this church would lay their hands on me and pray for me. They would give me words. They would speak things into my life. That was all good. But when it came down to it, I had to receive what those words were. And I had to get before the Lord and communicate with him and let him speak to me about my personal life as well. And if there was adjustments that needed to be made, if there was things I needed to do, if there was things I needed to say, you know, whatever, I was open to the Lord because, guys, I knew that I didn't want to die young. I had a family I want to live, I want to fulfill what God's called me to fulfill on this earth. And even though the enemy attacked me, I knew that God would deliver me. And it wasn't that I was a super Christian or I knew the whole Word of God or anything like that. It was basically the basics. Jesus came, shed his blood, not only to save me from my sins, but to heal me of sickness and disease.
Amen.
He took that leukemia on him when he died on that cross for me not to have it. So I had to make up my mind. Am I going to stand on what the Word of God says, or I'm just going to be que sera, sera, whatever will be, will be. That was the decision I had to make. Times of frustration came. Times of impatience came at times. But I knew that healing is for today. And if my aunt can be healed of cancer, if this person over here can get healed of cancer, if this person over here's blind eyes can open, things I've seen my whole life, things happen, created miracles. This one lady used to go here. She was born with one kidney. She got prayer, went back to the doctor. She wasn't even believing God for another kidney. She went back to the doctor. They took some x-rays for her, and she came back in. The doctor said, well, both your kidneys are functioning normally. They look great. She goes, well, wait a minute. I only have one kidney. Her name was Linda Ennis. She used to go here for several years until she moved out of town here several years back. The doctor, no, well, you got to look. And he showed the x-ray, and she just, you know, God gave her a creative miracle.
We've seen things like that. Steve Connors that goes here. He's had two creative miracles. Two things happened to him. God went in and cut the tumor out of his brain.
Amen.
He went in for surgery, and the doctors 4 or 5 times shot dye into his head trying to find the tumor. They couldn't find it. All they found was a piece of scar tissue where someone already came in and cut it out. He's got proof. Medical proof. That's God. It's not Steve doing it. It was God. So I know he can do that for him. He can do it for me. Who else do we have to believe but the word of the Lord, man? Nothing else. There might be facts. You know, you might have this in your body. This might be in your blood. This might be going on in your family. There's just well-known facts. And it's a fact that my kid's acting goofy. It's a fact that this is happening. It's a fact that that's happening. But facts are subject to change. And when you speak the word over that fact, and you speak the real fact, it begins to take place. It begins to grow. Life begin to come into my body. At one time through that whole year, when I had zero white blood cells, zero immune system, no immune system. The common cold could have took my life. Not one time did I get sick that whole time. Because the hand of the Lord was upon me. There was times I felt kind of cruddy and kind of but not sick to where I had to go to the hospital. And I'm not bragging on me. I'm bragging on God.
Yeah.
Because I chose to believe the word. I chose to speak it. I chose to sing it. I chose to worship the Lord. Even when I felt cruddy, I still worshiped God. I still kept my eyes on the end result, and that's the manifestation of the healing power of God coming out of me and rising up in me. I knew it was coming. I just kept my eyes on it. That day. That day's coming. When the doctor is going to come in and he's going to say there's no leukemia in your body at all. And that day came October 12th of that year. Diagnosed in January of 08. October came around. They did another bone marrow on me and they were blown away. You can ask Pastor. He'll tell you. I was obviously on drugs, didn't know what was going on, but he talked to the doctor personally in the hallway. The doctor came out in the hallway and said, your son's bone marrow is perfect. He could tell by looking at it. Then they called me the next day. We can't find any leukemia in your body at all. And the kind that I had was the kind that they could suppress, but never get out of your system. But Jesus knows how to get it out of your system. And he did. He absolutely did. So see, I'm a believer in divine healing. I know that Jesus heals.
Yes, he does.
So it don't take much for me to muster to pray for somebody because I know he'll do it.
Yeah.
And that's like you. What is your gift? What do you thrive in? What do you know is a reality in your life? Maybe you know that God will take you from the bottom and bless you and raise you and give you everything you need, meet your needs. Maybe you got a revelation of that. You got an understanding that God will take care of you. And you're able to minister that to other people. Look, this is where I was. But this is where God has brought me because I put my faith and I trusted Him and I followed Him to the best of my ability. Maybe that's your portion. But whatever it is, do it with love. Step out. Be bold. Be strong because the Lord your God is with you. Hallelujah. We used to sing that song, right? Be bold, be strong, for the Lord your God is with you. Some of those songs were awesome, those scripture songs, man. I like those scripture songs. Grew up singing those as a kid.
That's how
I got a lot of the word in me growing up is singing praise and worship songs. They were all scripture songs.
That's right.
Most of them. They were the word being sung over and over and over. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Amen.
We have overcome the enemy. By the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, guys. Our testimony. That means to keep saying it and saying it. Keep repeating it, repeating it, repeating it. Keep testifying, testifying, testifying.
about what God's doing. The best thing, one of the good things you can do is during the day, walking around and, man, God, thank you. You did this for me. You done that for me.
Right.
Thank you, God. You know, every time you have a chance to share with somebody, man, you know, the Lord just did this for me. He healed me. Every chance I get, I say that to somebody.
Amen.
When I come across somebody that's maybe sick, or I'm standing there talking to them in the store or something like that, come to find out they're sick or something, I will take the time to say, you know what? Jesus healed me of leukemia in 2008. Really? Wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Some folks will give you the old eye roll.
Yeah.
You know, but that's okay. But most folks will be like, wow. You know, and that opens the door for you just to share a little bit about what he did for you. And then you say, he'll do it for me, he'll do it for you because he loves you just like he loves me.
Yeah.
Where you're at right now. He loves
sure.
you. Can I just pray with you? Sure. Then you just release healing into that. You just pray for that. You know? Or whatever it is. You just take an opportunity to share something that God has done with you in your life miraculously, or just how he's provided something good for you. You share that with somebody. Every chance you get, you share it. You're not only blessing them, but you're speaking the word of life. Some folks will want to hear it. Some folks won't want to hear it. I'm sure at that crusade that Shane did out in Huron the last couple of days, some folks were there and they didn't want to hear it. But they heard it anyways.
Yeah.
I'm telling you. There's nothing like hearing the word of God. And sometimes that'll haunt people, man. If you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I heard a story about Graham Cook. He's a minister, and he was confronted by some Satanist. He said, "We're gonna, you know, we're cursing you. We're gonna curse your ministry, your family, and blah blah blah, all this kind of stuff." And he said, "Well, you do whatever you gotta do, but I'll just keep praying for you, man." And just made the guy mad. Just made him mad. And the guy turned around, and Graham Cook said, wait, before you leave. And the guy turned around and goes, what? He said, I'm going to pray every day that Jesus will visit you and you'll be saved. And the guy just, you know, freaked out about that and took off. Well, Graham Cook did. About 2 months later, he gets a phone call. He's at his office. He gets a phone call, and it's the man. It's the Satanist. And he said, stop praying for me. I don't want, you know, that Jesus was showing up into his bedroom and talking to him and loving on him. He was just fighting against it. And he finally said something along the lines of, no, I'm going to keep praying for you. Well, I'm cursing you and all this kind of stuff. Well, then you curse me and I'll pray, you know. And then come to find out here down the road a little ways, there was a big satanic meeting that these guys were going to get together, this coven or whatever you call these people. They're going to get together and have some kind of ceremony. And they had this big bonfire lit, and all these Satanists were gathered around this bonfire, and this man was there, that man that he was praying for was there. And Jesus appeared to him out of the fire. To all these Satanists that were there, this cult appeared to him. And they all fell over backwards, and they all ended up getting saved and giving their life to Jesus.
Praise God.
That man now is one of his workers that works on his staff. He's been working with him for like 15, 20 years or something like that. And you see what happens is you speak the word to somebody, it's with them. It stays with them. I remember as a kid hearing the word of the Lord and going out and doing stuff I shouldn't do and all that, and you would just hear that word in your heart. Oh, no. You know this is wrong. You know this isn't right. You know. When you speak love to people, you speak the word to people, it haunts them sometimes. It stays with them. It won't let them go. That's a wild story, man.
Hey, sure.
Stop praying for me. You know. Nah, I'll keep praying for you. I love you too much, you know. Love covers a multitude of sin, man. It's good, amen.
Yeah.
Guys, today's just been one of those meetings, this morning and tonight. The scriptures we've talked about, I can see a vein there where God is just saying, look, rest in me, trust me, know that I'm with you, know that my hand is with you, know that I'm protecting you, I'm keeping you, I'm blessing you, I'm loving you. Know to get your eyes off what's going on in the world and get your eyes on me. Listen to what I'm saying to you. Listen to what I'm saying to the church. The body of Christ, your brothers and sisters, listen to what I'm saying. and go along with what I'm saying. Say what I'm saying, do what I'm saying, agree with what I'm saying. That's all he's wanting us to do, is to serve him. And he'll keep us. Guys, our future's bright. It really is. You as an individual, your individual walk with the Lord is bright. He's got so many good things for you guys. I don't care how old you are, how short, how tall, it doesn't matter. He's got good things for everyone that loves him. And he's going to use us mightily in these last days, guys. Be ready for it.
Yeah.
Stay in that training mode, man. When you're spending time with him, you're hearing him, you're understanding what he's wanting to do and say. Stay in that mode of spending time with him and training with him, because he is raising up an army of believers. And that word I read this morning about the year 2017, how things are going to speed up in the army of the Lord in 2017. God is going to speed some things up for his harvest. So be ready, because I'm telling you, we got work to do, man. And it's going to be good work.
Amen.
It's going to be glorious work. And it's going to bless thousands upon thousands of people that love the Lord. I believe it.
Amen.
How about you?
Amen.
We need Moses and we need Elijah. We need the Word and we need the Spirit. We need both of them to come together and keep that good balance of the Word and the Spirit. Amen. And God wants to use us in both those, the Word and the Spirit. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Lord, we thank you for tonight, Lord. I feel like I've shared everything that I need to share tonight. And Lord, I just sense, Lord, in my heart, and I don't know who it is or what's going on. It might even be somebody online. It might be somebody here. I don't know. But I just sense that they know that they've kind of stepped away for a little while, and they know in their heart they need to get back in line with you, Father. So, Lord, I just pray for that person or those persons right now in Jesus' name. And if that's you, just simply before the Lord right now, in your heart, just between you and Him, just ask Him to forgive you. Tell Him that you love Him. Tell Him that you want to get back on track, get back in His pathway with Him. And just let the Lord know that you want to follow Him all the days of your life. That you want to be restored and get back in the walk that He has for your life. And He will do it because He loves you. That's what He wants to do. He wants to bless you. He wants to help you fulfill what He's called you to fulfill on this earth. So if that's you, just make that simple adjustment. You don't have to come down to the altar. You don't have to do any of that. Just make that simple adjustment in your heart between you and Him. And just give Him everything. Give Him all your life. Just make that decision and He'll bring you back.
Very well.
Right away. Instantly.
Yeah. Yep.
So Lord, I pray for that situation right there for those people, Lord. I just thank you for blessing them. I thank you for helping them, Lord. I thank you for seeing their hearts, God. And I thank you that your peace comes upon them in the name of Jesus. And that, Lord, they can see where they're at, and that you show them things to come as well. That you use them for your glory, Lord. That you give them dreams and visions, God. And let them just sense your love. Let it overwhelm them, Father. That you love them, and you have a call for them, a plan for them, Father. Thank you for doing that, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Just bless my brothers and sisters, Lord, for that. Thank you, Father.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Before we close tonight, before we leave, I just feel in my spirit tonight that we just need to pray for the law enforcement. And not only in our city, in our county, but around the world.
Yes.
But I just feel like we need to pray for our law enforcement here in Madera County. Tonight before we leave. So I'm just going to say a prayer. Just agree with me tonight for them, because things are getting kind of squirrely out there, you know? And I got a lot of friends in this town that are police officers, a lot of them,
yeah,
that I've grown up with. And in other towns around this area too, Fresno, Kerman, even boys I've coached in baseball are police officers now, some of them. So, Lord, right now, in Jesus' name, we just lift our law enforcement up tonight, Lord. We pray for them.
We ask you, Father God, to protect them. We send angels of protection to stand charge over these men and women, Lord. And Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus Christ that your hand is upon them. We pray for the police officers, the sheriffs, the prison guards, God, everybody that's in law enforcement in our country, we lift them up before you, Father. And the families that have lost loved ones, Father, we pray for them, Lord, for blessing them and helping them, God, having compassion on them, or restoring them, giving them peace, God. But Lord, we speak the blood of Jesus Christ over these officers, God, and this law enforcement, Father, this community. We speak the blood of Jesus over them. We pray for their protection. We thank you, Lord, that you'll deliver them and help them out of traps and situations, God. And Lord, use the ones that are born again, spirit-filled believers, Lord. Use them not only to reach their fellow officers, their colleagues, God, but give them witness, Father. Warn them of things to come that aren't good, God.
Amen.
But use them by your Spirit on the field out there in the name of Jesus. Give them insight, Lord, on things to come. And Lord, we just speak protection over them in the name of Jesus. We ask you to bless them and their families, God. We ask you to bless them with peace and favor and protection, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And we love those men and women for laying down their lives for us daily, Lord, to keep us. And we speak blessing over them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I just felt like we needed to do that
tonight.
In my spirit. Amen. Guys, I love you. You guys can go home. I love you.